ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Meanwhile Here on Earth. This program features in-depth conversations with the leading names in the subjects of UFOs, abductees, the paranormal, panel discussions, and the very best and brightest of the next generation of writers and researchers. Meanwhile, here on Earth, the show breaking new ground in alternative talk with your intrepid host, veteran investigative writer and researcher, Peter Robbins.
And good evening, afternoon, or morning at whatever time you are watching this show after the fact or live right now in real time. This is, in fact, Peter Robbins. The show is Meanwhile Here on Earth. And this is a special show for us. It's not paranormal, but it's not normal, although it is for some. My guest tonight is an old friend, and let me just bring him in here and we'll get cracking. Eric Bloom is an American musician, singer, and songwriter, best known as the co-lead vocalist, guitar, and keyboard synthesizer player for the legendary band The Blue Oyster Cult. He is the recipient of 5 gold and 2 platinum records, and his work has appeared on more than 20 of the group's albums. Much of his lyrical content relating to his lifelong interest in science fiction, which dovetails to a degree into an interest in UFOs. And Eric Bloom, welcome to Meanwhile Here on Earth.
Peter, and glad to see you. We don't see each other often enough, so even though this is through the waves,
years past.
Yes. And for your listeners and the viewers, Peter and I have known each other for 50 plus years. And
we met in 1968.
Yes. And Peter's sister, who we all loved, was the girlfriend of our drummer, Albert. Yep. And that's how far back this goes, a long time ago.
It does. And first, it's really a pleasure to have you on the show. I should tell you, our theme song that brings us in there with the mellifluous voiceover by Race Hobbs was written by none other than Albert Bouchard, your former bandmate.
Well, there's no reason why it shouldn't. His stuff is great, and no reason why it shouldn't be on your show.
Eric, I want to begin at the beginning. I know you were born in Brooklyn and grew up in Queens.
Yep.
Can you tell us a little about your childhood?
Therefore, the Mets hat. I hope we don't run afoul of the Major League Baseball showing a logo, but go ahead.
Hopefully, they won't be listening to this broadcast.
Okay.
So, can you tell us, we have some parallel parts of our lives. I was born in Queens, and then my folks moved Helen and I out to Long Island when we were kids. Sister Anne came along, so came of age in Nassau County. You, paralleling that, also grew up on Long Island. Can you tell us a bit about your childhood, your parents, and your siblings to start with?
Well, that's kind of, you know, that's private stuff, really.
Well,
let's get
enough
down to the meat of this stuff. My interest in what your subject matter is started with, I had an older cousin who knew I was grew up watching Buck Rogers and Flash Gordon on Channel 13.
Right.
You know, and I'm older than you. So, I mean, I'm older than everybody just about. So, you know, when Blue Oyster Cult started, I was 24 and I was the oldest guy. And except for Perlman, you know, I mean, listeners that are not, don't know anything.
We'll
about
be talking about him a bit for sure.
Yeah. Well, we only have 2 hours, and this would probably take 10 hours to tell everything. but it's hard to tell. I mean, I've been in Blue Oyster Cult for 50 plus years. So in a 2-hour interview, it's hard to tell everything.
Yeah.
So You know, Blue Oyster Cult's lyrics are heavily steeped in fantasy and science fiction.
Yeah.
And Sandy Perlman was our mentor, and he really was heavily steeped in the idea of extraterrestrials.
Yes, he was.
And therefore, even though Sandy and I never talked about it a lot, I found a like-minded person in his, you know, I'm not sure if it was his belief or in his artistic view. I never really found if it was the crux of his ideas or his artistic view, or I never really could pin him down if he really believed in it or if it was just something that he wanted to write about. But for myself, I can talk about maybe from when I was a little boy, you know, in the late 50s.
Where did your interest in science fiction really begin?
It really started with black and white TV, because that's all there was when I was a kid, you know. Yep. In the mid-50s, there was no such thing as color TV, or not many people had that yet. For people in their teens or 20s or 30s who are watching this show or listening, hard to believe, folks, there was no color TV. Yeah, there was a time. And nor cell phones or GPS or any of the stuff you take for granted. So in the 30s, and I'm not talking about when I was not alive in the 30s. I'm not that old. But there were Flash Gordon and Buck Rogers serials starring Buster Crabbe.
Yes.
And Buster Crabbe was an actor. And he was, like many actors who were physically fit, played Tarzan early on in his career, like Johnny Weissmuller and other people.
He broke in fact, as an Olympic swimming gold medal winner, which is how Hollywood first saw him and brought him in, because he's a great-looking character. And ignore that.
Yeah, ignore that. Sorry.
It's in the other room, but we still hear it.
Yeah, it's in another room.
It's a part of the joy of live radio as opposed to podcast.
Yes, I'm sorry. I'll disconnect that after a bit. Hold on.
Okay.
All right. My sister.
I wanted to. I remember some of those.
Because she's 92. Oh. It's better than if she couldn't call.
Not a problem.
Go ahead. Where are we?
Talking about the origins of your interest in science fiction began with Buck Rogers and Flash Gordon, which, of course, as we know, were originally
both played by Buster Crabbe. They were serialized things from the late 30s. And I would watch, of course, I couldn't see them in the theater because they were from the 30s, but they were serialized and put on what is now PBS. But back then, there was Channel 13, which was running in New York City television.
That's right.
And so I was thrilled watching them. It had ray guns. It had spaceships, pretty crappy spaceships, but they
seemed
spaceships
to run on coal. It had quite a exhaust. I have to cut you off for a moment, because I've remembered a favorite moment with Flash Gordon. They land on a new planet, and it's Flash, it's his sidekick, it's Dale, the pretty girl that travels with him.
Yeah, Happy was the sidekick.
There you go, and a good name for sidekick. And Dr. Zarkov, the scientist, foreign, obviously, from another country. And they land. And Happy pushes the button that opens the door. And as it's going down, Dr. Zarkov rushes up and he says, "Are you crazy? We don't have any idea what the oxygen is here. The atmosphere. Everybody step back, step back." And he goes, "It's oxygen. All right." And what? Even for a kid.
Well, the same scene happens in the sci-fi movie When Worlds Collide. When they just open the hatch, they say, "Well, we don't have any choice." You know,
that was it. Yeah, that was it. They really did.
A wonderful George Powell movie. In any case, I was thrilled by those movies. And I used to get like a blank art book. My father was in the art business, art framing and things like that. And I used to get a blank art book. And I used to redraw ray guns and rocket ships and stuff like that, and big fins and flames coming out of the back of rocket ships. Of course, on TV, they used to show V2 rockets, you know, from World War II. And I would redraw those and big flames shooting out the back and get a, you know, a Crayola crayon set and, you know, draw the orange coming out of the back. And I wish I still had those books. But in any case, that my interest goes all the way back there.
I want to ask you about another interest that begins for us as kids. You and I were lucky enough to grow up at a time when, you know, think about the sweep of the narrative of the early decades of our life and the popular music that we were hearing, the birth of rock and roll, Motown, rhythm and blues.
I'm a little older, so mine starts with doo-wop.
I wanted to ask you, number one, some of the memories you have of the music, not that you just listened to as a kid, but that got to you, that you felt bringing up feelings. Also, as somebody who has always loved to sing as an amateur, except for some years after my sister died, Helen and I used to sing together a great deal. And it wasn't, to kind of jump around here, it wasn't until you guys invited me to join you on stage at the memorial show that a bunch of people contributed to at Don Hill's Club downtown to sing Don't Fear the Reaper with you. I had not sung for several years because it just brought up too many feelings. And what were some of the songs that were going through your mind, elementary school, junior high school, that, you know, developed the beginning of your love of popular music?
Well, I was just a listener. You know, I never really thought as a kid I'd ever do it for a living. You know, I remember, like, I think Officer Joe Bolton came to our school. Now, for your listeners and viewers, he was a cop on TV who had
WPIX.
Yeah, you had a kiddie show, chapter 11, channel 11. And right. He came to our school. And I remember he said, raise your hand if you know what you want to do when you grow up. And I raised my hand and he said, okay, you. And I said, I want to be an astronomer. And I really wasn't really sure what even that meant. All I knew it was outer space because I wanted to go. There was no such thing as an astronaut, you know, because it was like the fifth grade. And, you know, that would have been about 1956, you know, 57, 56, 55. Yeah. And nobody had been in space yet. It was before Sputnik. So my interest in outer space and all that stuff started with that. We could jump to when I was about 13, mm-hmm. I had an older cousin gave me a subscription to Fantasy and Science Fiction magazine.
Whoa.
Now, that really changed everything for me because I wasn't much of a reader before that and wasn't the world's greatest student. And I started reading that voraciously. And also those magazines had great artwork on the cover.
They did, always. Yeah.
Fantastic artwork. And I devoured those magazines. It came monthly and it's full of great golden era science fiction writers.
Wonderful.
Heinlein and Theodore Sturgeon, et cetera, all the great writers of the late 50s. And so I devoured all those. And then of course, on the other side, the technology side, you know, Sputnik gets launched.
Yeah.
And the space race. And
had a big impact on us as kids.
Yeah. And then where else do you want to jump to, Peter?
Do you remember a time, let's say adolescence, 13, 14 years old, right around the time that you're getting into science fiction reading, where you have like favorite groups, so you're starting to really be more discriminating in your thoughts about the kinds of music that's on the radio, because that's really where we got it, that you're enjoying more than another type?
Well, you know, I went along with the times. You know, I watched Dick Clark daily. You know, that was my show, like everybody else who was my age at that time. And I learned how to dance by watching the Dick Clark show.
Yeah.
And trying to emulate the kids in Philly who where that show was based, and trying to learn how to dance by copying the kids on that show. And yes, Blue Oyster Cult fans, I used to dance. Because when you're 13 and 14 and 15, you know, that was an important part of your social milieu. You
it
know,
really was for us, no question.
And, you know, you wanted to go to places and meet girls and stuff, and you used to have to know how to dance.
It's one of the reasons.
You're just sitting against the wall.
So many of the songs that we grew up with were about dancing, or the song was introducing a new dance. And one of the great songs of the 60s for me that Helen also loved, and we used to laugh about it, and she ultimately did a cover of it. I think it's the Contours' Do You Love Me? Which for us was the most wonderfully obnoxious love song in the world. The guy opens up by saying, you know, you blew me off, but I'm back to let you know that I can really dance, and proceeds to literally scream his way through, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Now that I can dance, I can mash potatoes, I can do the twist. And it's joyous, and it's obnoxious, and it's goofy. And it was just kind of emblematic of the fun of rock and roll and dancing, which was a big part of my life too back then. Do you have any thought at all about ever being a musician or singing at
not
that?
Not then.
Interesting.
No, not at all.
So
it wasn't until I got to college where I really got the bug. You know, I bought a guitar my junior year of high school and fumbled around with it a little bit, and really was not very good at trying to learn, just trying to learn the basic chords and stuff. And I sold it as when the neck started to bend, because it was a real cheap piece of junk.
$52, and, as I recall.
Yeah, right. And I bought it from a mom and pop music store. Boy, did my mother hit the ceiling when I bought that guitar.
That's like more than half $100. Are you insane?
Yeah, you know, absolutely. And everybody came down on me like, what are you out of your mind paying that kind of money for a guitar? So I think I was 16.
And, you were out of your mind then.
Yeah. So when I got to college, I had it for a little while and sold it and the little $10 amp I had, literally a $10 amp. That was used, and didn't even think about it for a while. Then I don't know how much more you want to talk about music, but
this takes us right into 1966. You are now in a group, Lost and Found, and
yes,
this segues into a situation where you meet guys from another band, starting with Donald Roser, Alan Lear.
Well, that's a few years later. Yes.
Okay. How did that transpire? And at that point, you're in college, you're studying. Maybe you're
no,
not going to be.
I met them after college.
Oh.
Yeah.
So you graduated. Remind me again, you graduated with a degree that you thought was going to allow you to pursue what?
I graduated
career?
With a degree because it's the only thing I could take without studying. Because I was a lazy guy. And all I wanted to do was smoke some dope and meet girls.
I have nothing.
It was the 60s, Peter.
Exactly. And unless you were there, it's impossible to explain. It's, you know, it's become just kind of a cartoon or a caricature or.
Yes, everything changed. Yeah, I had a very good friend who passed away many, many years ago. And he was a famous guy. And he said that everything changed every decade. And the 60s were the 60s. And when it got to be 1970, everything changed. And everybody in his address book he called was totally, the phone numbers were different. And they didn't want to talk about the same stuff anymore. And I found that to be very true. The 80s were very different than the 70s. 90s were very different than the 70s, 80s. I learned a lot from him.
So but, you've graduated.
I graduated with a degree in Romance languages. And even at that, I was a bit of a jagoff.
So you're now a graduate.
I graduated in 67, a year late.
So at this point, do you think you're going to make a career in Romance languages, or has this...
I wasn't sure because I still had the draft.
And you, like me, were able to not fight in Vietnam.
I was pretty sure about that. But that's a long story that we won't tell here. But I was accepted to graduate school.
Good.
And there's a long story I won't tell about my draft physical, my second one.
We can compare notes sometime.
Yeah. Well, you know, Albert has his story too, which is interesting. But to cut to the chase, with the draft behind me, I met the guys at the Sam Ash Music Store, which I took a job there. There's much more to tell. It would take the whole 2 hours. But, maybe we're getting off topic and maybe too much music.
Not at all. I don't know.
This isn't, your show is not about my career in music.
Well, it is today.
Yeah, it's up to you.
Continue on.
Now, I met the guys in the band at the Sam Ash Music in Hempstead, Long Island. And I had been working there about 10 days when they walked in to buy amps, and I was their salesman.
Oh, gosh.
So, and that's basically why we're talking today.
The band was not the Blue Oyster Cult yet, of course. They were the Soft White Underbelly.
Yes.
And a wonderful name. And an early shot here.
Yes. That's the band but without me. The guy in the middle was Les Bronstein. And the guy on his right shoulder, Andrew Winters, was the original bass player.
Mm. And then flanking on the left is original.
That's Albert
drummer.
On the left and and Alan on Les's left shoulder and Donald on the far right.
I wouldn't have recognized Alan. He's such a kid there, although everybody's young.
Well, that picture is probably 1967.
And they were living in a big old house in Great Neck, Long Island.
Correct.
The band house. And invited you to move in as a member of the band. And you did?
A member, well, actually, oh, God.
Were you still, you were the road manager first.
Yeah, well, to cut a lot out, I'll just tell you that I met them at the music store. I got a call from Les, who I went to Hope Art College with, and asked me, could I come down and do PA for them at the Electric Circus in Manhattan?
One
night in 68, Thanksgiving Day night, 68. I did the sound for them. I also turned them on to some goods that night. We all got kind of wasted. So after the show, Perlman comes up to me. I'd never met him before. And we get Sandy's name here again. And he was their manager. Yes. And he had gotten them a deal on Electra Records. And that's why they walked into Sam Ash to buy amps, because they had some advance money. And we were all in good spirits. And Sandy said, how would you like to come to the band house? They needed a tour manager. And I was living on my sister's couch. And I said, fine. So I was out of Sam Ash and into the band house starting Christmas Day of 68. Now, unknown to me, they were having personality problems with Les.
What, within a band? I'm shocked.
Which I didn't know about. And during the course of living in the band house and hanging out with everybody and doing stuff with everybody, again, very, very long story. It would take too long to tell. Alan heard some tapes of me from my bar band days and told the guys that I might be a good substitute, you know, to try. So that's what happened in April, May of 69. And Perlman asked me to come down and talk to the guys, and the rest is history.
The band house has strong memories for me as well. Helen had moved in with Albert, and I remember they painted their bedroom with rounded corners. It was, I can't explain it any other way. It was just as goofy and wonderful.
It was a wacky place.
Yes. You had all set up a wonderful studio with egg cartons on the walls.
A lot of corning fiberglass in the walls to stop the sound, the noise.
And occasionally I would come out for a weekend or something. Other guests would come and go. It's at the band house that I first met, probably in 1969, Patti Smith, who went on to a certain amount of notoriety, as I recall.
Yes.
A woman of letters and internationally respected, although back then she seemed to me to be very shy. Her poetry was her main thing. This was before she had gotten in together, I think, with Robert Mapplethorpe. And I remember waking up on the couch one morning, and there was another guest staying there, I think from the West Coast, very shy guitarist, who I learned later was named Jackson Brown. Richard Meltzer, the legendary rock critic and avant-gardist, would come by every once in a while. I remember...
I got there, Richard and his girlfriend were living in a glass porch off the living room. And I moved in there Christmas Day of 68.
Jeez.
And Richard was living in this porch.
It's cold.
And Andrew was living in a bedroom in the attic. Alan was living in a bedroom in the attic, and I had no place to go, really. So I was living in on a couch between Andrew and Alan's room. There's no place, no other room.
Times were tough. It was rough sometimes to get...
Yeah, it was like scrambled eggs and Spanish rice. A lot of
communal meals. Truly struggling. And I remember once, it's a point of great pride for me and a footnote in the history of the Blue Oyster Cult. You guys were up against the wall one month. My sister talked to my dad and he paid the rent that month.
Well, there was all kinds of stories of, we used to go play, there's a guy down the street about 6-7 blocks, and he would find work for us from time to time. And he walked in one day and said, I found a gig for you guys, but the stage is only big enough for three of you. So three of you guys, you pick three guys, and there's a gig for you guys. So of course it would usually be the drummer, the bass player, and Donald, you know what I mean? Who else could it be? So they'd come back with $150 or $200. So we could eat for another week or buy some oil, you know, because it was in oil for heat. So there were lots of strange things like that.
I remember.
Another side note, once in a while we get hired for a Friday, Saturday night at some bar in Long Island.
Yeah.
And after Friday night, they said, don't come back tomorrow. That's true. And more than once.
What are you going to do, as Tony Soprano would say? The reality of, being part of a creative collective and not knowing where that next dollar is going to come from. But, you know, not wax corny or anything. You guys had a dream. Bands were starting to really make it big at that point. And I want to flash back for one moment here. At a certain point, maybe like me, one night you're in bed listening to your transistor radio. It's early 1964, and you, for the first time, hear a song, the one that was released first, by an English band called The Beatles. Do you remember that experience?
Not exactly that way, but I was a sophomore in college in 63, in the fall of 63, and a guy I knew in my dorm had been in England that summer and brought back Meet the Beatles, the British album.
Oh, my gosh.
Before it came out in America. Wow. And he said, oh, there's this band in England that everybody's talking about, and I have their album. And there was a, quote-unquote, hi-fi in the, like, a rec room in the dorm. Yep. And he put it on, like, this big wooden console.
Yeah.
So we all listened to it way ahead of anybody else heard it.
Wow.
Because we didn't know anything about the Beatles.
Sure.
And just listened to it and sort of scratched our heads about it and looked at these, you know, the mop haired guys.
Yeah.
And said, we really didn't know what we were listening to because there was no Beatlemania.
How interesting.
No hype, hype, no
English invasion.
Yeah. No, nothing yet.
Yeah.
So, I remember a friend of mine who was a drummer said, oh, that guy can't play drums.
Yeah. It didn't work out very well for him, did it?
No.
At this point, you guys, again, you're working on your own repertoire. You're working on songs, maybe doing covers. Who was your favorite band or bands at that point before things broke big for you guys and, you know, you had a dream?
Oh, we all listened to, well, I'll tell you something. I got a little education from the other guys because, like, for instance, when I moved into the band house, I was really into R&B. My bar bands, well, first we did a lot of British Invasion stuff, but before that I was doing James Brown, Wilson Pickett,
whoa,
you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I was a front man of all those bands. So I was doing like a blue-eyed soul kind of thing. And then I joined another band when my band, remember I stayed an extra year. So I picked up with the guys who wound up being Lost and Found, and they were doing different stuff than I was used to. But I had a whole bunch of gigs. So they said, oh, we'll adopt you. So I joined these guys and they were doing different kind of material. So they sort of, I jumped in with them. That was my last year and a half in school. So then when I met the Underbelly guys, they were doing all originals, which was just something I never did. So you got to remember what the early Underbelly material was like. It was kind of avant-garde and almost Grateful Dead kind of stuff, the kind of San Francisco kind of stuff.
Yeah.
If you listen to the really early recordings. Things changed a little bit, you know, when I got involved and started to rock out a little bit more. So that's when we made one album for Elektra. Jack Holtzman, the president of the label, didn't like it. And then went back to the trough and made the second one out in California. And that came out as the quote unquote Stalk Forest album. And Jack Holtzman didn't like that one either. So we were off the label. And then we sort of struggled for a year or so. And then Perlman got us in the door of Columbia. And then again, the rest is history.
Rest is history. And let's go back to Sandy here because, you know, there are a lot of producers that become well-known in the work. They have their own following, their own mystique. Sandy Perlman was one of the most remarkable thinkers of anybody I ever met. He had one of the most creative, fluid minds. You think about the lyrics that he supplied to the band over the years, but more a vision. At a certain point, of course, years later, he went off and got another band in gear. Some people may have heard of them, called The Clash. He was right there at the birth of punk. Died much too early. And I told you I had a story about him. In 1976, I'm less than a year into my obsession with UFOs and what happened to my sister. And Sandy was aware of it. And you guys were recording at a studio in the West 40s. It was, I guess, working on songs for Agents of Fortune, which was a game changer for you guys too, I guess, in great part because Don Roser's song Don't Fear the Reaper, far and away probably the most popular or best known Blue Oyster Cult song, was on that album, as well as songs by Patty and Helen. And he took me aside and he said, you know about this UFO stuff. You know, I'm an expert. I'm into it for 9 months. But I did have starting to build a library of declassified documents, which were authentic and real. And he was looking for some inspiration for a song. And he asked me if I could make copies for him. I did. And they went to him. And ultimately, that song turned out to be Extraterrestrial Intelligence, or better known as ETI. And I just want to go over the lyrics quickly here. This is Sandy's lyrics from 1975. This is almost 50 years ago. I hear the music daylight disc. Yeah, three men in black said, don't report this. Ascension, that's all they said. Yeah, sickness now, the hours dread. And then the chorus, all praise, he's found the awful truth. Balthazar, he's found the saucer news. Wait, there's more. I'm in fairy rings and tower beds. Yeah, don't report this, three men said. Books by many and by the dead. There's a king in yellow and queen in red. All praise and back to the chorus. And then kind of this, for me, a line that could have come from a song about the invasion of the body snatchers that we end on. Dead leaves always give up motion. Well, I no longer feel emotion. When prophecy fails, the failing notion, yes, don't report this, Agents of Fortune. He was a poet. He was a visionary. And was it Sandy who came up with the name, the Blue Oyster Cult?
Yes. Let's stick with ETI first.
Yeah.
Donald wrote that song.
Oh.
And he had different lyrics on it. And the majority, because Blue Oyster Cult is a democracy,
yeah,
didn't care for Donald's lyric. So Sandy said, it probably is around the time that he asked you for some inspiration, which I never knew till now, came up with these alternative lyrics. And he handed it to me and said, sing this. Because that's me singing. I'm the one singing that song. So we laid the ETI lyric on Donald's track. So Donald wrote the music, Sandy wrote the lyric, and I'm singing it. So, and I sing it almost every night because it's a very popular song.
Yeah.
And of course, it's open to interpretation, you know, what the lyrics mean.
Yes.
I never explain it to anybody. Because when you explain the song, it changes to me. You know, what do you mean by that when you say that line? And I, you know, I say, well, what do you think it means?
Exactly. It's poetry.
It's let people's mind go wherever they think it should.
Like looking at a painting and telling, you know, everybody has a different take on it and different meaning.
Yeah.
A quick question flashing back again, more for my own curiosity and to confirm something that I think I remember, which was Les Bronstein, who, of course, began as the BOC's first lead singer.
Soft White Underbelly's first singer.
He had sold a song to Peter, Paul, and Mary, which they recorded. Yes. I'm in Love with a Big Blue Frog.
Correct. And that's when he was a student at Hobart College.
And, I mean, Peter, Paul, and Mary were huge. They were as big as folk acts get. And my best sense was he thought, I've sold a song to Peter, Paul, and Mary. My ticket is written. And he left the group. Did he leave, do you think, because of that impetus? Or, you know,
well, no, there's years in between those statements.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wires crossed?
Peter Yarrow and Peter, Paul, and Mary, his brother went to Hobart College, Andrew Yarrow.
Okay.
So I think Andrew connected them. Andrew was a nice young man. He He didn't live very long. I think that's the connection. Peter Yarrow heard the song, thought it was good to use. And what was great for Les was they made it the B-side of Leaving on a Jet Plane.
Of course. Of course.
So
that was a monster.
That bought Les a Volkswagen bus. back a long time ago. So Eric, it's an interesting story.
There's a point. You guys are now the Blue Oyster Cult. You're rolling.
Yes.
You're doing gigs. Yep. You're actually beginning to pay your bills by being professional musicians. Did there come a time when a particular show or an event made you realize, my God, this dream is coming true? We are a band and we're growing and we have, you know, a popular following and we could be major and this is going to be my life. I can't believe this dream is happening. Was there a point where that really dramatically, that transition you were aware of per se and then moved into the next phase of your professional life?
Yes, I think it was last week.
Why do I bother sometimes, folks? Good. Let me ask you this. Going back to that period of time, you guys are working band. You're starting to meet guys in other bands, some of them really famous bands. And you're getting to meet well-known people and, you know, have nice meals and stay in hotels. You're living the life. You're a rock star. It's not a figure of speech with you, like a rocket scientist.
Well, you know something? All of that is overblown, I'm sorry to say.
I'm talking about other people's vision of you rather than your perception of yourself here.
Yeah, but I have made friends, you know, in other bands. There's no doubt about it. But as sure as anything, the travel and all that, and the hotels and all that stuff is the bane of every rock musician.
The novelty wears off fairly quickly.
It's you know, maybe in the first few years, you know, hey, you know, I'm not home, I'm on the road. Oh boy,
yeah, that's it.
You know, but you know, all the airports and all the changing through the airports and all that stuff, yeah. And getting, you know, landing and how to get to the hotel from here and getting to the sound check and getting no sleep. You know, it's really pretty trying. But it is part of the deal.
Part of the deal also, and we all know this because we all are fans of some people and singers and bands and musical groups out there, that if you go to a live show, you know, you're paying your money and what you want is to see the group that you are there to see singing that song or those songs from that album sounding like it does on the album, and you can get the thrill of seeing it live. For me, first, you are now a professional performer. When you're a vocalist, your body is your instrument. You sing, and there's a resonance that you feel. It brings up sometimes strong emotion. Other times, it's just a show, and you've got to get through it. But you have to appear that you are really into it. I mean, the first times I remember in the 60s, seeing guitarists labor on their guitars like, this thing weighs 500 pounds and I'm in pain now. I'm going, all these expressions on my face. I mean, it's an act on a certain level, but it came from an initial connection, a deep connection with the music. I'm going on here, but you are aware when you perform that people not only want to hear things the way they want to hear them, they don't want you to look like you're bored. You have to look like you are into it, even when you are not, even when you are singing that song that everybody wants to hear.
Well, I feel the same way as a fan of other bands. I feel the same way.
Hmm.
If I go to see The Who, you know, I'm expecting to see The Who with a capital W, you know? So,
yeah.
You know, I get it.
let me ask you this. Back when you guys were starting out, late 60s, early 70s, was there even a molecule in your body that thought, oh, I'll be doing this in half a century? Or, this is going to be a gig for 4 years and then I'm going to go get a job or something.
It's open-ended. There's, I mean, there's times, dozens of times where I thought that this was it, dozens. Mm. Where, I'm packing my bag and I'm not coming back, but it just keeps going, I mean, our phrase is on tour forever, but I don't know where forever is, I don't have any answer for that. We're off now till June 26. We have bookings and more coming. So I think 24 is, kind of solid, but we're taking some time off right now. Richie is got a tour with John Anderson, so he's got some stuff coming up, but that's not why we're taking a break. But it's we're giving him a chance to go off and have some fun. He's a very talented guy.
Eric, you've seen close up and at a distance so many talented people, singers, songwriters, guitarists, but people in the business who reach an unimaginable level of popularity, almost a hysteria around them. But at a certain point, maybe they're starting to lose themselves in drugs or they're genuinely not happy. How have you made it through? I mean, I'm sure you've lost count of talented performers you've known who, left us too early. Did you ever have a crisis around that, or you managed somehow to, keep your stability and, be a working musician without having to fall into that pit?
I it's a hard question to answer because I never really, I went through the 60s,
Yeah.
No, I was a pot smoker, like everybody else I knew, even though that was a little tight group of friends, when it was, we were heads,
It was exotic and we were part of the counterculture.
Yeah, it was counterculture. That's a good word. But, like I said before, as soon as the 60s ended, got into the 70s, I don't think I've gotten high in 30 years. It's just nothing. It's not for me anymore.
Yeah. 1976, a new genre of pop music comes on the scene in America. Its first kind of appearance and emanating out from there is at a nasty little hole in the wall club on the Bowery called CBGB's. And the genre is called punk. Do you remember your first experience of punk or what you thought of it when it came along? I mean, you guys are generally classified as heavy metal. There are other genres, but what did you first think? And do you remember some of the first groups that you saw in that genre?
Well, I preferred it to disco. there was all kinds of genres every couple of years,
Yeah.
There's the disco, there's punk, there was the hair bands, there was, every once in a while there's a trend.
Yeah.
Then there's rap and there's hip hop, then we go through a phase where there's pop, there's always pop running through everything.
Yeah.
Through the whole thing. Right now is a big resurgence in pop. And now, country Western, and then there's the pop side of country Western. It's hugely popular now.
Yeah.
So, I look at the top 40 from time to time. There's no rock in it. I can't say rock is dead. It's not really quite dead.
No,
but there's, no rock and roll going on anywhere, anyhow, anymore. I think all the rock and roll is in the, on the classic music scene. And does tremendous business live.
Yeah. It would be putting you on an unfair spot, and almost creating a situation where you would have to be the ultimate name dropper. You have, and you know, your band colleagues as well, have met so many extremely successful, legendary performers. And like all people, you know, you never know the essence of somebody or have even an idea of their character, their empathy or lack of same until you have an opportunity to spend a little time with them. And in no way am I interested in or even curious about some of the jerks that you've met along the way.
I would like. I wouldn't tell you.
It's a long list, I expect. I would like to know, though, about some of the performers who are truly famous and legends in their own way that you've met over the years who have really touched you or impressed you as people with their kindness or maybe a bit of advice or their ability, you know, to just relax and hang out with them without, you know, putting on any airs. Who are some of the people that come to mind, if I might ask?
Well, that's tough because I'll probably leave people out and then they'll be pissed off. Because I can't think of them all in one sitting.
Fair. I understand. Fair enough.
Yeah.
But there are some.
You know, I'll give a couple of special mentions. And then if I leave people out, I apologize.
And it will be understood that all of those people are still beloved and continue.
Yeah. I mean, I wrote a song with Ian Hunter. He's a great guy. Very, very talented. And still going, still on tour. And although he told me, he says he makes more money staying home than going on tour because he's a great songwriter. Oh. So he gets great royalties. So, but that's a long time. That's about 20 years ago he told me that. So maybe it's different. But he's a prince of a guy. And then another wonderful guy is 80 Money.
Oh. I'm glad to hear that.
Mick Box, Uriah Heep, great guy. You know, and all the guys in that band are great guys. These are, you know, guys we tour with. The guys in Nazareth, great band, great guys.
Yeah.
Rick Nielsen, all the guys in Cheap Trick, they're all great guys.
Oh.
You know, we tour with so many different bands that we just bump into. The guys in April Wine, Canadian band. I believe they're Canadian, am I right? I think they're all good guys. John Kay, Steppenwolf, great guy. Good, all the guys in the band are nice guys.
Mm.
The late, great Ronnie Dio is a great guy. He's from upstate New York. You know, a quick anecdote. In my bar band days, Lost and Found, I was like a junior, senior in college. No, I was a senior in college and I stayed an extra year and played in the band. And then, so I played 2 years in that band and I played all through upstate New York with that band. And I wouldn't say Ronnie was my competition, but we bumped into each other because his band was like a whole league ahead of me.
Oh.
Played for much more money and did much better gigs than me. I was, you know, he had a truck with a lift gate. I mean, we shoved our shit into the back seat of a car, you know. He had a roadie, you know. He had, like, crew. You know, we had just friends that would come and help us, you know. So, he's one of the best bands I ever saw in that genre. One of the best copy bands I ever saw. But then he... I don't know if many people know the real story of Ronnie James Dio. It's not his real name, but I won't go into that. But I think his fans know his history.
Sure.
But one day, I won't tell the whole story because it gets a little
strange.
Well,
we've also got about 90 seconds of this hour left, so we'll pick up.
All right, in 90 seconds, I'll tell it fast. I'm playing a fraternity party at Hobart College. Across the street is another fraternity house. And then I can't tell this in 90 seconds.
Not a problem.
But I'll tell it on the other side.
Yeah, sounds good to me. This is Peter Robbins. My special guest tonight is Eric Bloom. The show is Meanwhile Here on Earth, and we will be back in about 4 minutes and 15 seconds. Don't go away.
Hey, UFO conference enthusiasts. We've got another great event for you in 2024. The Saucers and Aliens Kansas UFO Day in Dimension G is being held in the UFO capital of Kansas, Geneseo, on July 6th. This is a fun festival in the middle of nowhere. There will be a parade, decorated yards, costumes, vendors, speakers, and a showing of the movie The Day the Earth Stood Still. Appropriately, an 8-foot-tall statue of Gort and a statue of Klaatu will be dedicated. This will be the only museum in the U.S. with these custom-made statues. If you'd like to donate to the statue project or attend the event, visit GeneseoMuseum.com. That's GeneseoMuseum.com. Be sure to bring your camera when you attend the event. That's GeneseoMuseum.com.
And Peter Robbins back on Meanwhile Here on Earth with my special guest tonight, Eric Bloom.
How you doing?
Back again.
Peter, when are we going to get into ancient aliens?
We're about to start that. My first question for you in that zone is, at a certain point, at least no later than junior high school, your interest in science fiction started to incorporate an interest in the real phenomena of unidentified flying objects.
I hope we didn't lose all your usual listeners.
No, we probably
don't give a shit about the music business.
That's the least of our worries here. I think we may well have had added more BOC fans, so it all evens out in the great spectrum of the reality. I completely lost my train of thought.
Are you talking about 13, 14
ancient
years
aliens?
Old,
yes, exactly. So you write a book report on what for us in the world of UFO studies is a very famous and respected one, Captain Ruppelt's book, Unidentified Flying Objects, etc. What caught your interest about the subject of unidentified flying objects? Do you remember what it first was?
Being a crazy sci-fi guy like me as a 12 or 13, 14 year old, I walked into the candy store near my house. Now, there's something ancient alien right there, a candy store. The candy store near my house was called the Utopia Luncheonette, which was in Queens. It was about as ancient as you can get. It had a jukebox.
Oh.
It had a place where you could buy a hamburger or a tuna fish sandwich on the little seats that you could spin. It had, you could buy cigars, candy,
a fountain
gum.
Coke.
Fountain Coke for a nickel. And paper books on the stand that spun around.
Right.
And one day I'm in my local candy store, which is a block and a half from my house. And what do I see on the paperback stand? But Ed Ruppelt's book about flying saucers and Project Blue Book.
You had heard about this flying saucer stuff.
What else could be more up my alley than that? Now, remember, there were movies about that stuff that were science fiction.
Yeah.
Earth versus the Flying Saucers.
The best.
And many other movies like that. And so I grabbed the book. I don't remember what it cost. $1.99? I don't know.
I'll
whatever
bet
paperbacks
less.
Went for back then.
Yeah.
And I bought it. I read it voraciously. Even though it was, not fiction.
Dry. Yeah, it's,
Yeah, it was dry. But I still read it voraciously because, wow, here's the real deal.
Exactly.
You know, wow, this is real stuff. And so I think I was in the eighth grade. What year was that, Peter? 57, 58. I was in junior high, so I wrote that for either seventh or eighth grade and wrote a book report on it. So I don't still have it, by the way.
What a shame.
I wish I did. I read that book and loved it. And because here was the first time I ever read anything. See, to me, as a 13 or 14 year old, I could not believe that adults believed in flying saucers.
Interesting.
I thought it was kids' stuff. You know, I mean, how can an adult? Now, you got to remember, there were late night TV shows that had on kooks. I'm talking about real nutcases that said they'd been to Mars and stuff like that. Now, I don't know if you remember that. Guys that said, oh, yes, I've met Martians. Yes, they shake hands like this. You know, and stuff. I said, yeah, right, dude. And even at 14, I knew these people were out to lunch. You know?
Yeah.
And I said, you know, there's no air there. Come on, man. Come on, let's go. So finally, but reading a real book, you know, that seemed to be factual.
Yes.
You know, even though it poo-pooed it, you know, at least it had some facts in it that I could read and said some real people have really studied this and gone through it. And I could read between the lines and say, oh, yeah, well, how about this? Well, how about this? You didn't really read through this. You didn't study this. And even as a kid, I could see that there was stuff they really didn't look into.
Yeah.
And that sort of started my question marking over my head.
You know, you said something very interesting, which that you thought that adults would have naturally assumed this is nonsense. There was a moment, the life-changing moment for me toward the end of the UFO sighting Helen and I had when she was 12 and I was 14 in Rockville Center, where I really wasn't into science fiction. I was 14. I was into rocks and bugs and collecting stamps and coins and singing to a degree, reading. But for whatever reason, UFOs weren't on my radar or the implications. And all of a sudden, there we are in front of our house on a beautiful, cloudless morning, looking up and seeing five silvery white disc-shaped objects in a pronounced V formation. And I had no grounding whatsoever. Like you, I had seen, you know, some of the great black and white fictional movies about UFOs, but I knew, as well as a 14-year-old can, my understanding was that they were real, but in movies, kind of the same thing that you were thinking, but a different way of saying it. And all of a sudden, there they were. And what happened to me toward the end of that experience was shutting down emotionally and saying, if this is true, then everything that I thought I knew from the adult world is now open to question. And that is not okay with me. And so I do joke with people and say, if I have other repressed memories from childhood, I don't remember them. But that memory, a lid went on it. And I would say within a week, maybe 2 weeks, I had done what I now would consider impossible. I'd completely forgotten about it. And over the next 14 plus years, it came up once in a very distorted kind of way. And the lid went back on, which was on my first LSD trip in 1966 or 67. But I really could not handle that memory. And the lid went on until I was ready to deal with it when I was almost 30 years old. Did reading that book take you into other books or looking toward wanting to know more, seeing documentaries or finding people to talk with this about it? Or was just, you know, one more kind of interesting thing in the background of your life?
Well, I was still only, you know, a kid. So I didn't want to be a researcher or anything like that.
Sure.
But I filed it away and, you know, it certainly piqued my interest. And then I think the next book I read was Incident at Exeter, which is, you know, probably, you can't call it the Bible of the genre, but it's certainly a very important book. And that's a terrific book. And, you know, that book goes back very, very far, and they keep talking about it. It's like, to this day, there's a special about it about every 5 or 6 years. They keep bringing out her dress and saying, look at this, you know, and keep, you know, more and more researchers are digging into that incident.
Did you start to follow like Unsolved Mysteries and those shows as they started to?
I watch all those shows. The only thing that bothers me about them is they just rehash everything. I mean, they have Shatner doing one, and they have another actor doing one, and you know, I mean, everybody they can get a hold of is doing a who solved these same things over and over and over again.
Yeah,
Unsolved Mysteries.
And when they began, of course, at the very beginning, when it was Robert Stack, Elliot Ness, doing the voiceover, right. Which was terribly exciting to me. I appeared on one of those shows in the late 80s with Bud Hopkins as his assistant. And when it came on TV, the most exciting thing for me was there I was watching it. I'm on TV on a national show, but Elliot Ness, Robert Stack is... That was too cool.
I like Expedition Unknown, too. I think that's a good show.
Yeah. And you have followed the show, Ancient Astronauts, I'm imagining, from its inception to some degree.
I like most of those shows, except the, you know, they tend to rehash some of the same stuff over and over and over. There's just so much stuff that's unknown, so they look at it again.
Now, your touring schedule in the early 90s, I'm sure, was pretty busy. But do you remember when this new show called The X-Files broke into TV lineup?
Yeah, and I liked it up to a point until they started, like, getting away from the extraterrestrial side of it.
Yeah.
They started looking at more other stuff. Yeah. You know, let's stay with the aliens, please.
Eric, you, as a reader, have always been focused on science fiction. Is there any other area, fiction or nonfiction, that you find yourself returning to over the years as a reader?
Well, yeah. Right now we got Shogun on again. I love the original. Right. And I read all the Clavell books.
That was the next thing I wanted to ask you, because... Mm-hmm. Clavell is such an internationally successful fiction writer that you collaborated with him on a song?
No. I collaborated with Michael Moorcock, who's a science fiction and fantasy writer, three songs. I collaborated with Eric Lustbader on a song. He wrote The Ninja. And the Miko.
That's what I confused it with. Okay.
I've co-written with a couple of authors.
John Shirley.
Yeah, he's Donald and I have co-written several songs with him, almost whole albums. And he's a very interesting guy. He wrote the screenplay for The Crow.
Whoa. That's major.
Yeah, that's with Brandon Lee. I think most people have seen that movie.
I want to ask you a little about your creative process. You have written music and lyrics over the years. Do you remember how it began? Because you did not grow up, you know, studying musical composition or painting. That first creative blast of the guys around me are writing music, I can do it too. Where do I even start? And do you remember where you started and what you started with?
Well, I moved into the band house not knowing what my future would hold. and they were all songwriters.
Yes.
Everybody.
They're amazing.
And also a guy like Joe Bouchard, graduate of Ithaca School of Music.
Yeah.
You know, a trained musician.
That's right.
Could read and write music. You know, I didn't know anything. To this day, I can't write music and I can't read music. So
you can sure sing it and play it. Something.
I don't think McCartney can either. So I'm in good company. Not to compare myself with Paul. Sorry.
That's great.
But I felt peer pressure.
Interesting.
Yeah. So I said, you know, I better get on the stick here. You know, so like on the first record, you won't find hardly any writing credits from me because I just didn't know what the hell I'm doing. Yeah. You know, the other guys had been writing for quite a while.
Yeah.
So, you know, starting on the second or the third record, I started saying, I better get my shit together, you know? So also our writing, the way we started writing, starting maybe around the second, third record, would be all of us in a room. And that allowed all your ideas to pour out in a room full of guys.
Great.
Not necessarily guys. I'm not saying it was sexist. I'm just saying that five of us in a room with guys.
Yeah.
So if we're working on a song and somebody says, I got this idea like this, and if I change the idea and say, I don't think it should be that way because off the top of my head, I think it should be that way.
Mm.
That's a writing credit.
Yeah.
You know, especially if we keep it that way.
Yeah.
So if you look at Secret Treaties, I have a lot of writing credit because a lot of those songs were written in an ensemble situation.
Yeah.
Also, we had a band house that year. And out on Long Island, we had a band house out in Eaton's Neck, which was a small little town near Northport. And it had all our band gear was in the living room. So when everybody left, I very often would be alone in the house until the next day of rehearsals or over the weekend next day's rehearsals.
Sure.
So I might just sit down. They had an old upright piano in the house. And I just would like sit there and bang away, not really knowing what the hell I was doing.
Yeah.
And very often ideas would come unasked for. So that's the way things happen.
Have any songs or what became a song, the basis for a song, ever come to you in dreams?
You would think so. And unfortunately, probably 100 songs came that way. But they're never there when you wake up.
Mm.
Or you get an idea in that drift away time before you're going to sleep. And you go, I hope I remember this. And you don't. A lot of people I know keep a tape recorder or their phone right next to the bed.
Yes.
And they turn on the little tape recorder in the phone and mumble, do 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 da do ba do 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 do, and they make a little file because that's to remember that moment.
Yeah.
Or if they're on a plane, they'll do the same thing. And if you don't do that, it's gone.
To dovetail for a moment, years ago when I was in therapy, there was a period of time, and it's not uncommon for folks in that situation, where your dreams, your attention is on them more. Your therapist is interested in what you're dreaming. For that period of time, I kept a notebook, a pen, a flashlight, and a regular cassette player on my end table. And, you know, you do your best to remember a thought or a dream, but you're dealing, you know, with that. If something comes to you as you're going to sleep or while you're asleep, it's like working with spider webs. It's so ethereal. You can lose it. And what might have been, you know, a classic song that would have resonated with people for decades isn't born. Other times, whether or not it comes out of your experience or that collective experience of writing, you know, together, two very different experiences. Do you prefer one to the other, or they're just different experiences and they produce different kinds of
In all results? These years of trying to either collaborate or write a song, I've only written that BOC has used only one song has just my name. But there's a lot of songs I collaborated. Buck and I like wrote a couple of whole albums, almost completely. Ones we did 20 years ago,
yeah.
Two records. I went up to his house and we just bashed away till we had a whole album's worth of material. I made a few trips. This is when he was living in upstate New York. Then the last record we did 3 years ago, Richie and I wrote a couple of songs together, and some of it, actually, it's interesting the way things work. Buck came over to me in an airport and says, we really need some lyrics on this new record.
Mm.
And it motivated me. I got on the plane and I jotted down some lyrics that just came to me on the airplane. And wasn't a full song, but just some phrases. And both of them became, I laid on Richie, and Richie expanded on them with me, and we finished two songs in a rent-a-car. You know, and you just never know how stuff happens.
The song Take Me Away really addresses the subject.
I don't want you to knock Albert out of the theme song of your program, but that's the perfect theme song for your program.
Race, we're going to have to evaluate this. And I expect
it's,
that we
by might... the way, it's autobiographical.
Talk about the song first, because we're going to listen to it.
I'll talk about the song right now. Aldo Nova, who had a hit many years ago, he's a Canadian guy. He was living in New York, and he was opening for us. He was managed by our management, and he hands me a cassette one day. He's a great guy, by the way. He hands me a cassette. He says, I got this song. It didn't make my album. And he says, because people didn't like the lyrics. Now, this stuff happens. You got a great track, but the lyrics don't seem to work for everybody. So he hands me this cassette. And he says, see what you can do with it. So I take the cassette home, and I saw what he meant about the lyrics, but the music, you know, was rocking.
Yeah.
So I saw him the next day, and I said, give me this track without those lyrics. So he hands me the cassette back the next day. So I had a reel-to-reel machine at home.
Oh, boy.
For your listeners and viewers, a reel-to-reel machine is an old-style tape recorder. You know, one of those things. And that's what I had for a home studio. So I put his track on my reel-to-reel machine, and I sat down with a yellow pad and came up with the lyrics. So just sitting on the floor in my basement in about an hour. And that's what the song Take Me Away is. It's about, it's autobiographical, about if the aliens are listening. So if those radio waves are going out at the speed of light, its song's pretty old now. I'm waiting for them to hear it and come get me.
Kind of a nice bookend to ETI. We're going to listen to it, but it's an MP3, so we won't have the wonderful classic video that goes with it, which also...
Well, people can find it on YouTube, Take Me Away by Blue Oyster Cult. It's kind of a cheesy 80s video.
Yeah, but, exactly.
We can play
it's fun. It's fun to watch.
Strange shapes light up the night. Never seen one, though I hope I might. Don't ask if they are real. The men in black, their lips are sealed. That's verse one. But, you know, play it. Have people listen.
We're going to play it in a moment, but I want them to hear the full lyrics before we do. Can you continue?
You have them in front of you?
No. Do you have them in your head?
That's I haven't sung it in a while.
Okay.
The chorus is, I turn my hopes up to the sky. I'd like to know before I die. Memories will slowly fade. I lift my eyes and say, come on, take me away.
Race Hobbs, will you drop the needle on that song for us?
Strange shapes light up the night. Thank you. Don't ask if they are real. The men in black, their lips are sealed. My mind beneath this place before my time. Release myself from earthly care. My dream may be your nightmare. Come on.
Yeah. Do you think sometimes about the fact that everything that you guys have recorded that like has been on television or radio waves going out into the cosmos, that there may be a time when, you know, the planet that first picked up I Love Lucy and the Honeymooners decades ago is starting to hear songs that you were involved in writing somewhere out in deep space?
Well, that's the plot of Contact, the Carl Sagan movie.
Exactly. Yeah. I want to.
Which is a wonderful movie, I think.
It is. It's a thinking person science fiction movie. And aliens have been treated and mistreated in so many amazing ways over the years. By the way, the picture.
But you know, the late Alan Lanier, who you knew quite well, he always, yeah, I mean, he liked science fiction too. Yeah, there he is. He said, you know, we used to ride together a lot because we were the only two guys in the band who liked sports. he said, well, what makes you think that the aliens are going to come down and cure cancer? He said, they might come down here and kick our ass. He said, every time there's a weaker civilization, the stronger civilization comes down and kicks their ass. He said, so don't wish for aliens to show up quite so fast. So,
Alan,
you know, I mean, he had a point.
Yeah.
So who knows?
Let's talk about Alan a little. He was incredibly talented.
Talented and very smart.
And very a nice person in a world of people who had a lot of artifice. When I met him again, he and Patti Smith were a couple and quite electrifying in a quiet way. The shots that I just showed before are from your 40th anniversary show in New York City. This shot and this other one of Alan and Patti are, they're obviously dressing room shots, but they're from a gig that you guys did in 1975. And I'm not sure whether it was the Palladium in New York. I think it was the one time that this new group that I thought were just absolutely as silly as they could be and didn't have a chance of sticking around. They had a gimmick and it was pretty superficial as far as I was concerned. I think their name was Kiss. It could have been.
I mean, we did a show with Thin Lizzy and where our gear didn't show up. And Patti, I think, was on that show also.
God. There's a moment in the world of, well, for certain people, popular culture honors them and makes them, in the mind of a lot of us goofballs, somewhat immortal.
the moment that the Blue Oyster Cult was depicted on an episode of The Simpsons. I mean,
yes,
I'm not worthy. How you guys, you, and then of course, and I'm curious to know how you learned about this or whether you guys had a heads up on this beforehand. Chris Walken appears as a guest on Saturday Night Live, and they decide on a skit that.
No, we did not know about it.
Oh, my.
No. And obviously, there's Chris Parnell playing Buck Dharma, although they called him Eric. So they didn't know everything.
No.
And Horatio Sanz is playing Joe Bouchard to a T. Which is
and they've got
funny.
The Albert-looking guy, not with his cowbell. So somebody called you and said, you're not going to believe this, but you guys were just spoofed on Saturday Night Live?
No, I saw it live.
Oh, you just happened to be watching?
Yeah, I watch SNL. So I was sitting on my couch at home and said, behind the music, Blue Oyster Cult. I go, oh, my God, they're going to tear us a new asshole. So I had no idea what was going
to
happen.
It was just fun from beginning to end.
Well, I didn't think so at first. I thought, you know, I was more dumbfounded. You know, I mean, who's going to turn on the TV and watch them do it to you? You know?
Well, again, it wasn't mean-spirited. It could have been.
No, you know, no, not at all. I didn't think it was mean-spirited. I just was kind of shocked.
Another, I don't know if this resonated with you guys, but it did for me in part because the lettering that you guys were using, that very wonderfully Germanic metallic lettering, your the double fold album with the church and the limousine, it was
on your feet or on your knees,
there you go, and that was a shit kicker. That was a great record. And the inside fold of you guys on stage. My question is, a movie comes out, a fake documentary, coining the term mockumentary, and it's called Spinal Tap. Well, this is Spinal Tap. And it was about a heavy metal band, somewhat lost souls. It was hysterically funny, and it wasn't necessarily coming after the Blue Oyster Cult, but that choice of lettering for me, like a lot of people who love the band and were close to it, made me wonder whether or not you guys were partial models for it in the most superficial way. Any thoughts on that at all? And the wonderful fake documentary that it is.
Well, I can't speak to what they had in mind, but it certainly is a conglomeration of every band, you know, maybe 10 different bands.
Yeah.
You know? There's a little Uriah Heep in there. There's a little Blue Oyster Cult. There's a little bit of every band like the above. You know, I mean, being lost in the bowels of a theater looking for the stage, that's, you know, not too strange.
Been there.
You know, all that stuff. You know, it was that movie is dumbfoundingly true, you know, in many places.
It's also so funny. Rob Reiner, you know, just sort of hit that the right nerve at the moment in time. Also, I love the fact that all the guys who played the characters, if they didn't know how to play, they learned how to play, and they wrote those wonderful songs. That
exactly so.
Are still hysterical.
And I often wondered with the song Big Bottom, how many people watching it noticed they're all playing bass? You know, I'm sure every musician watching it noticed that.
Well, there's that scene of Christopher Guest in the green room, and he plays, how can I say this, one of the numbest-brained, missing everything, fabulously superficial. And
oh, about the small sandwiches.
Oh my God! Look at the size of the bread and the It still tears me up. It's a very funny movie.
It's just not right.
No, it's not. And it isn't. You know, there should be nice little tiny pieces of meat. Or why serve you those pieces of... you guys, of course, food on the road is, you know, you've got to live and you've got to eat. But every once in a while, it's either wonderful...
How did we get from extraterrestrials to sandwiches in the dressing room?
Because even extraterrestrials, I'm guessing, die if they don't consume nutrients at some point. And we will, again, this nature of this show is going back and forth between Earth music and those guys out there. Talking to you is just such a fun opportunity to pick your mind about...
Listeners and watchers, I'm trying to steer Peter to the good shit, and he wants to talk about sandwiches.
It's, folks, you heard it here. Find another show to listen to next week. But in the meantime, do you remember, you know, you're on the road and people are covering your meals. Really, one of the best meals that you ever had, or one of the worst meals that you ever had? And then we'll move on from the world of food and rock and roll.
I can't answer that question. I don't know. I mean, you know, do you want to talk about catering?
No, not necessarily.
What the fuck is wrong with you?
You have, and the guys, traveled all over the world. You've met people that you would have never met otherwise, some of them who I am sure remain extremely friendly acquaintances, or over the decades have become friends. You know, things mutate. Are there any particular countries or locations that you have visited as a performing musician that have stayed with you over the years that you just would love to go back to at some time, or have the best memories of in terms of people or the location itself?
Well, places we'd like to play?
Well, places that you enjoyed, whatever you enjoyed about it, whether it was performing, the people that you met, or this amazing country or this countryside or this cool city that you would like to return to, or...
There's a lot of great places to play. I mean, we play all across the UK. It's a wonderful country.
Yeah.
Great people. We have great fans there. We have great fans all across Europe. We like to tour there. We played Sweden Rock last year. We played. We headlined a nice, smallish venue, 5,000, in north of London last year. And in the 80s, we played some big monster of rock, Jagunda festivals, you know, in Germany. And those are great. That's with like a lot of acts. The late Bill Graham, who was a wonderful impresario of rock and roll, he held these big festivals called Days on the Green, which he did in Oakland and in San Francisco. And those were shows that actually can't be reproduced because he ran them so well and it was so unique. You know, shows like Heart, Ted Nugent, Blue Oyster Cult, Journey, you know, Cheap Trick, all on one stage, you know, crazy kind of shows. Wow. And and he ran them so well, he would have like a swimming pool backstage and 10 pinball machines and, you know, cotton candy machines and just, instead of having just like a hockey player's empty dressing room, he would put tapestries on the wall and oriental rugs and
nice.
He really knew how to run a show.
Yeah. It was terrible when he died.
Yeah. He's a great man. And just things have gotten a little bit too businesslike maybe in the last 10, 15 years. And the personalities have changed a little bit. But, we still like to work and we still like, you know, some of the people running the shows these days. And we have, we're pretty close with some of the promoters we work with and some of the venues we play. So, it ain't all bad.
Do you have any memories of working a more exotic country? Well, I'm thinking particularly of Japan and Asia, where you guys come in to do a show and there are things that are lost in translation, or that you realize they're perceiving you in a way that you're not used to.
Well, I have a funny anecdote about playing
Please
Japan.
Do. Perfect time.
Well, I went to Berlitz. I was a language major, remember?
Oh, right.
So I went to Berlitz and studied Japanese before I went.
Wow.
And I took 30 intensive hours of Japanese.
Whoa.
Except it was very kind of polite Japanese. I got to Tokyo. And one of the guys from the record company came to my hotel room. And I said, well, this is the stuff I want to go over with you. So he started laughing. And he said, what? He says, oh, the audience is going to laugh at you if you say that stuff. That's like, you know, that's like too polite for a rock audience. And this guy had like, you know, a shag hairdo, and he was like had gone to high school in America. And so I said, all right, you got to give me the hip stuff. Tell me the cool stuff to say. So he gave me this, you know, back in those days, this is the late 70s, I had a whole little speech before Godzilla.
And in
Japanese, I said, you know, millions of years ago, long before man ever walked on the earth, there were huge reptilian creatures walking around here, blah, 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 blah. Like about a 2-minute buildup. So it was, Hyakomannen no mukashi, chikyu ni wa taksan no kaiju ga. And all in Japanese. So I memorized it after a while. But I had it all on like oak tag on the floor.
Of course.
You know, and magic marker on the floor phonetically.
Yeah.
So we're playing this big show. 3,000-4,000 people. So just before Godzilla, I start out with this whole Japanese rap, and I get halfway through that, and some guy yells out to the audience, hey man, like, what's that in English?
Perfectly realistic question. That's great.
I'll never forget that.
Curiosity, did you see not the newest, but just before the newest, from late last year, early this year, Godzilla Plus One?
Minus one.
Minus one.
Excellent.
That's dyslexia for you.
Excellent movie.
Did you see it in black and white?
I did. And I saw it the first week.
Wasn't it amazing?
It was the best foreign film of last year, and it's a shame it was not nominated.
I agree. And it was the best Godzilla film ever. It was so good. And I thought if we had watched it in color, we would have had a very different experience. And I think I much prefer the experience of black and white.
I think they put it out in color after a while. But I didn't see it in color. But I hope it comes to streaming sometime soon because I want to see it again.
Yes, I agree.
It had a very short theatrical release in December.
Was very lucky to catch it, basically, with my dear friend and ex-brother-in-law, Jim, at our local art theater, and we were bowled over.
It had a real story. It was not just a monster movie. It was really good.
Oh, no. Anything but. Have there been times when a member of the group, you guys get together, you've all been working on stuff, or some of you, and saying, I've got some new material here. I'd like to know what you think of it.
Well, I'm sure we all do that, you know, on occasion. But usually, that would be when we're working on stuff. You know, we have a goal. You know, our manager would say, we really have to come up with stuff. The label is squeezing our balls. We got to get a new project out by November.
Yeah.
So guys, get going, you know.
Do you remember a time when somebody comes in with a song? I mean, I'm thinking of some of the most iconic VOC songs where even on the simplest, you know, humming it or playing a cassette or strumming it on a guitar or just picking out a keyboard, where you found yourself going, yes, they got it. That's a song I want to hear that worked up, and that's got to be on the record. That's a great future BOC song.
It works both ways. Sometimes you think, you're really wasting my time with that. Or, you know, that has potential.
Yeah.
It goes both ways. Or, you know, it might say, you know, please don't make me work that up. You know, because you could take days working on a song that you don't think has any potential.
And
when you don't have days.
Yeah.
And I'm going back all the way to the beginning. You know, I'm not talking about right now.
Sure.
And then there's a buck brought in, Don't Fear the Reaper, finished.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't a sketch.
That had to be a session.
So there's a little bit of everything is when it comes to songwriting.
Yeah. I want to take a look.
We have about 10 minutes left. You want to talk about I'm having a senior moment. That alien show with the doctor. Resident Alien.
Yes, I would like to know your thoughts on that.
I love that show. I think it's very clever, good special effects.
Yeah.
And I think it's got a good plot, and it's very funny.
What are some of your other, like, all-time favorite shows? They can be anywhere in the world as well.
Let's go.
As...
That's, we this just came up in my chat on Facebook. Science fiction theater, which was a religious yes. experience for me.
Yes.
It was on 7 o'clock. I can't remember what night it was on. But it was hosted by a guy named Truman Bradley.
Truman Bradley. And we do you remember the theme? Yes, Truman Bradley.
And it was like a 25-minute screenplay.
Yes.
It was like pre-Twilight Zone.
Yes.
And I was a kid, but it was like a wonderful get me out of here kind of fantasy show.
Some of those shows were powerhouses. They really
were.
It was
you know, hard sci-fi or fantasy or it was pre-Alfred Hitchcock, pre-Twilight Zone, and a wonderful show. And I heard it's on YouTube.
Right in there, at that same kind of moment in television time, was One Step Beyond. With
One
our
Step
host,
Beyond was like John sort Newland. Of contemporary with Outer Limits.
That's exactly. Although I did prefer those two shows to Outer Limits. But the beginning
Outer
of
Limits
Outer Limits.
Could have been a little cheesy sometimes.
Yeah.
but know, they did when, so when much. When it came to special effects.
With so little. And you think about, we all think about the classic Twilight Zone episodes that were, you know, not just a part of our week as kids. I think they were Saturday night. And it was a family situation, get around that TV and what's the newest episode. But how they still resonate on such a powerhouse level through our culture, maybe now more than ever. Rod Serling lived very close, well, in this part of New York State and taught at Ithaca College for years. And they still have a Twilight Zone festival every year where they show, you know, perfect kinescope copies, and his daughter now is part of it. And I wonder, you know, without fantasy science fiction to inform some of our lives, how dry it would all be. And with that, I'm curious to know, you know, you do keep an eye on the UFO scene. We go back and forth regularly, sometimes several times a day. And
well, I send you everything I read or see.
Well,
most of it is BS because there's just so much easy CGI to fake stuff these days.
Exactly.
And usually you and I agree that this is fake or it isn't, or maybe it is, or maybe it's not. But
it's true.
But sometimes we both agree that maybe this isn't.
Exactly. And, you know, we are in the school of the supporting the X-Files mantra. We want to believe. All the more
I certainly
reason
do. Like that lyric in the song, Strange Shapes
exactly.
Light Up the Night.
Take me away.
Never seen one, though I hope I might.
Yeah.
I do believe that we're not getting the whole story from our government or any government.
Sure.
And there's a lot being unsaid. And I don't think we ever will be told the truth.
Have you had the experience of having this subject come up with well-known musicians? Just, you know, you start to talk and find out that you both got that interest. Or is this something that you don't talk about a great deal, your interest in UFOs, you know, over the course of your career with people that you interface with?
Well, it's not the first thing people talk about, you know. I mean, usually like something else, you know, about the gig or, you know, something related to the evening. Yeah. But, you know, people know where I'm coming from, yeah. You know, people who know me. And I do know a couple of guys we could talk about after the show that told me they've had experiences.
Yeah. Very good. The world of UFOs in music, for me, I think it started the very first song relative to ETI or aliens was One-Eyed, One-Horned, Flying Purple People Eater, which was very big when I was elementary school.
And what you might call a novelty song.
I think we should call it that. But there have been some wonderfully evocative, moving, serious, thoughtful, elegic songs with a UFO-based or ET theme. Any of them that stay with you that you particularly like for any reason? I mean, I'm thinking now of, well, David Bowie's contributions to the subject, the Jefferson Starship.
Well, you know, Blue Oyster Cult has a bunch of them.
That's for sure. That's for sure.
I mean, Buck wrote a song called The Vigil, which we play on occasion. You know, and Sandy's songs, his entire Imaginos epic is all about aliens that very much behind, you know, like I said, I'm not sure if it's something that came out of his head or something he believed about aliens that lived under the ocean that were guiding our history.
That may not be so far from the truth, and I'm not being facetious here. Almost anything is possible, and there is more attention, serious attention being paid to unidentified activity below the surface of major bodies of water. You follow what's been going on these last years with increased interest among certain elected officials, whistleblowers coming in testifying before the House of Representatives, most recently a report that came down from the Pentagon about a month ago, essentially an update of the original "nothing to see here, folks, move along." It's all explainable in conventional terms. Any thoughts on that as we come into our last few minutes?
Well, I watch most of that stuff, and, you know, there's always going to be he said, she said, you know, when it comes to our government. They've been trying to put stuff under the rug for 50 years.
Yeah.
You know, ever since that New York Times videos, an article.
Yep. December 2017.
Yeah. I mean, to me, I believe my eyes. And I believe the Navy pilots, and much more than I'll believe a senator or somebody from the House of Representatives.
Yeah.
So, and when you listen to the audio from those flights, and they said, well, there's a whole bunch of them out here, to paraphrase.
Yeah.
So it wasn't just the ones that are on the screen. Yeah. So,
tip of the iceberg.
Yeah. So I'd rather believe the pilots. And thank you very much. And I'll vote for somebody else next time.
Eric, I can't tell you how much I've enjoyed having you on the show and just reconnecting with you on a level that is several points up from Facebook messages back and forth. Hopefully you'll be able to join us again this spring or summer as part of a panel discussion. And you and I, of course, will continue to stay in contact. stay well, keep rocking, take care of that voice of yours. And thanks again for joining us tonight.
Last thing I want to say is on my Facebook page, I'm waving the Ukraine flag. And that's for a reason. My mother was born in a little shtetl outside of Kyiv. So I am part Ukrainian by birth, you know, by blood. And I'm just wishing the best to all those people there.
So are many of us, Eric. So are many of us. Peter Robbins here, my special guest tonight, legendary singer, songwriter, musician, Eric Bloom of the Blue Oyster Cult. The show is Meanwhile Here on Earth, and we will see you again next week.